Okay, welcome everybody. Our presentation today is cardiovascular patents. So today we will talk about the heart and mediastinum in general. So what kind of study we can perform in the cardiovascular system and mediastinum? We can do plain X-rays, ultrasound, fluoroscopy, CT scan, and MRI. So let's go to start with the chest X-ray. So in chest X-ray we have different view. We have a posterior anterior, lateral view, and oblique views. So let's go to start here exactly with the posterior anterior, the same and the chest X-ray. But here is very important, and when you talk about the heart, the X-ray should be done in posterior anterior. You remember why from our last conference. So in this case, the posterior anterior film is obtained when the patient facing the cassette and the X-ray tube is 6 feet, 180 centimeters away from the cassette. This distance decreases the effect of beam divergence and magnification of structures closer to the X-ray tube. So, for that reason, when you want to talk about the measurement of the heart or any structure, you have to take the X-ray in posterior anterior position. You have the two view, right anterior oblique view and left anterior oblique view. These are from the old school. We are not using this anymore because of the echocardiography. So let's go to recap the anatomy of the heart. You can see you have in the right side the right atrium, the superior vein cava. In the middle of the heart we have the right ventricle. And then from the in the left side, from the top to bottom, we have the aortic arch, pulmonary trunk, left atrial appendage, left ventricle, and cardiac apex. Now, to know if the heart is enlarged or not, that means we have cardiomegaly. We have to take the measurement of the heart. Okay, so we do it in this way. So to take the measurement of the cardiothoracic ratio. You have to measure the heart in the major white part, and then you have to divide that in the distance between both costophrenic angles from the interior part of the ribs, from the interior part of the ribs at the level of both costophrenic angles. So the result of that will be less than 0.5. If it's less than 0.5, that means there is no cardiomegaly. It's a measurement. It's more than 0.5, that means there is cardiomegaly. Remember that the chest X-ray to be done in posterior anterior position. This is for adults. In case of children of pediatric age, should be the result above for 0.65 to consider cardiomegaly in this case. Above for 0.65, remember that. This is a sample of cardiomegaly, and you see this is very easy to diagnose because of the enlargement of the heart. So this is just to remember the anatomical position of the valve. Remember, we have four chambers in the heart and four valves. We have a tricuspid, mitral, aortic, and pulmonary valve. Now, let's go to talk about the enlargement of the heart. How this cardiomegaly start to begin? So first, usually one chamber at a time. Okay, one chamber at a time. So let's see, we can start with the left ventricle dilatation, then left atrium dilatation, then the right cavity dilatation, or the right cavity dilatation, then left cavities in dilatation. So in this chest X-ray, normal chest X-ray, we can see left atrial enlargement. You can see both of part of the superior part of the heart are enlarged or white. That means there is enlargement of the left atrium. Now there is some causes that can cause that, like mitral stenosis or mitral insufficiency, left to right shunts, myxoma of the left atrium, that is a tumor, or right to left shunts, and endocardial fibroelastosis. Now, in case we have left ventricle enlargement, you can see there is growing of the apex of the heart. This groin is going to pass through the left ME diaphragm. It's going to pass the cardiac apex. It's going to pass through the left ME diaphragm in the S-ray. And there is these are the causes can produce a left ventricular enlargement. You can read about it. Now, right atrium. Remember the position of the right atrium is the inferior right part of the heart. So in this case that part should be enlarged like this one. So that's an early sign of the right atrial enlargement. And then we have left ventricular enlargement, right ventricular enlargement. So what happened in right ventricular enlargement? Remember the left ventricle, the left ventricle grew through the left ME diaphragm. In this case, the apex is coming up to the lung. It's coming up to the lung. That's a difference. So because of the right ventricular enlargement, we have Tetralogy of Fallot, pulmonary stenosis, mitral stenosis, core pulmonary, tricuspid insufficiency, and pulmonary atresia, and much more. They are the principal ones. So let's go and recap the enlargement of the heart. Remember, the cardiomegaly starts with one of the cavities, okay? With one of the cavities. Left atrium, left ventricle, right atrium, right ventricle. So we have your left, how the left ventricle is growing. It's going down. Even the right ventricle is going up the apex. And then the left atrium, right? This is very important to know. Okay, let's go and talk about another pathology, in this case, pericardial effusion. So, pericardial effusion occur when fluid collected in pericardial space. It's more than 50 mL. It's more than 50 mL. Our radiography features we have in the plain film, the chest X-ray, I'm talking about PA, a very small pericardial, and in this case, if you have a very small pericardial effusion, can be occult on plain film. And in large pericardial effusion, can be a low globular enlargement of the cardiac shadow, given a water bottle configuration. Given a water bottle configuration, remember you can Google this thing, design water bottle configuration in pericardial effusion, and they go to give the full explanation for that. Then the main diagnostic for this one is echocardiography, which is the method of choice to confirm this diagnosis. We can estimate the volume of the fluid and can assess the hemodynamic impact of the effusion in the heart. Also, it can guide you if you want to do pericardiosynthesis, I mean drain the fluid from the pericardial sac. So this is an example of pericardial effusion. You can see like a water bottle configuration. You can see it's similar to the top part of the any water bottle. Now this is an example of echocardiography. Okay, see pericardial effusion, pleura, the aorta, and this is an example CT scan in the pericardial effusion. It's very difficult to watch this here, but when we have our practical session, we will show you exactly what is echocardiography with examples. Now the another important pathology is the heart failure. Heart failure or left ventricular failure. Or left heart failure. They have different name for this disease. They have different stages. We have three stages. The first one is left heart failure. The first one is the rise of pulmonary venous pressure. You can know the bilateral upper lobe blood diversion. Okay. The second stage is the interstitial pulmonary edema. You can see this prominent septal lines at the right costophrenic angle. We will call it Kelly B lines. Okay. There are more type of Kelly lines. We have A, B, C, and D, which you have to to check that for yourself. That should be part of the assessment. And then the stage 3 is the left heart failure is pulmonary edema. Pulmonary edema. Pulmonary edema, you can see bilateral consolidations in the lumps, bilateral consolidation in the lumps, and we call it bat wing sign. So you can see why this is an example of why we call it bat wing sign. Is usually it remember us a bat. This is a bad wind sign. This pulmonary edema is a frequent disease. And if you know at with accuracy and promptitude, the patient can die. But you act very fast, the patient can survive easily. Okay? This is another TSSRI showing you the pulmonary edema. So you use the pulmonary edema and the bat wing signs. So this is another example for cardiovascular. This is aortic arch aneurysm. In your right is a CT scan about this one. Aortic arch aneurysm CT scan with that and we atheromatous plaques. That the arrows. Okay, atheromatous plaques. I hope you know what is atheromatous disease. So these are atheromatous the plaques which are causing this severe dilatation of the aorta. This is another example of the aortic arch dilatation. Now let's talk about very fast about echocardiography. Echocardiography, which is the principal tool for non-invasive assessment of the cardiovascular system. It's the principal tool for non-invasive assessment of the cardiovascular system. So eventually when you want to request about a heart, when you have a patient with heart problem, usually you request for ECG and echocardiography. That means ECG, electrocardiography, and echocardiography is a routine test for the heart. Now echocardiography is used to diagnose the majority of the vascular disease. Okay, they can give you the pulmonary strength and the location and extent of any damage to the cardiac tissue. And it's not only allow doctor to evaluate the heart valve, but they can detect abnormalities in the pattern of blood flow, such as the backward flow of blood through partly closed heart veins. So this kind of study is very easy to do. It can give you the report very fast. The only thing is quite expensive organ. Okay, so far from the cardiovascular system is enough for today, but you remember we have the Kelly lines you have to check out that very well. Remember here we check the heart failure or left heart failure or left ventricular failure. We check the pleural effusion, and we check the cardiomegaly, which is very important. Now I want to talk very fast about mediastinum. So the mediastinum is the region in the chest between the pleural cavities that contain the heart and other thoracic viscera except the lungs. You can see here the boundaries. You remember except the lungs. And they have the boundaries, you can read this one later. So there are some authors that consider the most superior portion of the anterior mediastinum as a separate fourth compartment. So in the, and other authors divide into seven groups. For us, let's go to divide it in three easy groups, okay? Anterior, middle, and posterior, that's for you. So these are the anterior mediastinum with the boundaries and the contents, which you have to know very well. Always you have to remember the middle mediastinum with the boundaries and the contents, and the posterior mediastinum as well with the same things. Now what happened? There is some diseases can project in the different compartments of the mediastinum. For instance, in the anterior we can find a thyroid tumor, thymitumor or cyst, teratoma or dermoid, lymphadenopathies, aortaneurysm, pericardial cyst, fat pad, and Morganian hernia. In the middle, we can find a thyroid tumor, lymphadenopathy, bronchogenic cyst, aortaneurysm, and hiatus hernia. And the posterior, we can find neurogenic tumors, soft tissue mass of vertebral infection or neoplasm, lymphadenopathy, and aortic aneurysm. So this is an example of neurogenic tumor. In the posterior compartment of the mediastinum, you can see it's raising from the spine, this huge round or oval opacity posterior to the heart. The example of neurogenic tumor. This is another example, it's a retrosternal goiter. You can see the CT scan, there's a chest spray. This is another sample, this is a mediastinal lymph node. You can see all the arrows there, CT scan and the chest spray. And now this other disease of the mediastinum is pneumomediastinum, which is A inside of the mediastinum, okay? You can see in the normal chest X-ray, you can find the pneumomediastinum. You can see the arrows there between the heart and the lungs. They should appear a lucent line that can, which can extend from the top to the bottom, from the top to the bottom of the heart, from the top to the bottom of the heart. Remember, if you have any doubt, you can Google or to YouTube. Anyway, we are leaving some assessment you have to check later about this issue. This is another mass of the mediastinum, in this case thymoma. This is X-ray and this is a huge mass in this scan is the thymoma. Okay, so I think that that's all for today. That's this is orientation presentation. So far, like I said, we talk about the compartment, we talk about the mediastinum and the pathology we can find in each of the compartment. Remember, anterior, middle, and posterior. So go for the complement materials which also loaded, and for your assessment. Thank you.